Good afternoon, everyone. I will be presenting a series of stent fracture cases that we did in last 2 years and the importance of wisely choosing the appropriate stent size or the stent type. Just to brief you about the fluoroscopic classification, this was published in JACC by Dr. Virmani and her co-workers. This is the first patient. She is a 60-year-old hypertensive lady who presented with class 3 angina. And this is the angiographic films of the lady. She had a 90% tight lesion in the LED and there was a big diagonal coming off. Circumflex was very, very short. This, in different views, we were not able to define the ostium clearly. So, and we had a possibility that she might require a bifurcation stenting. We went with a provisional stenting approach, and because we needed a pot, so we did a left main to LED stenting. We can see we employed a PROMAS element 3:24. After doing this, there was a significant mismatch between the proximal and the distal segment. So we post-dilated with a 3.5, 12 at 20 atmospheres. Since there was no IVUS available in the lab and we wanted to have a good post-dilatation of the left main, so we used a 4:8 at 18 atmospheres and again a 4.5:8 at high pressures. We had a decent result. There was a very good luminal gain and there all the vessels were flowing, but this was the stent boost image that we took. All of the stent had mangled out. Because luminal gain was good, everything was okay, there were cost constraints. So we decided not to deploy another stent. And there was no transection, there was no deformation. This lady presented to us 18 months later with angina. We did the angiogram of this lady, but fortunately for us, everything was flowing well. This is the angiographic view of the lesion. The diagonals were also flowing and the left main showed no significant abnormality. So another case was, this is another lady which was presented with angina, simple straightforward lesion. We engaged the guiding catheter, 6 French JR 3.5, and decided to put a stent. This stent was from the newly launched company by the name of Firehawk. We used a 2.5:23, and there was a decent 2.5 landing zone. We did not want to engage or put in a very long stent. Now, post deployment, this is the nitro shot. Immediately, I thought that, there was a significant mismatch as far as the stent was concerned. The proximal segment started looking a little bit more. And even the distal segment or the mid segment looked like it would require a 3 or 3.5 post-dilatation. So we decided to have a post-dilatation done. After doing post-dilatation for the proximal and the mid segment with 3 and 3.5, we started seeing some haziness in the stent. This haziness, we thought some thrombus formation had started. And although we had dilated to such an extent, we gave 2B3 inhibitors and some low pressure dilatation, but nothing was visible. This is one of the stent boost images that we took, and we could find there are multiple stent fractures. Possibly the post dilatation had disrupted the structure architecture and a medial tear produced a thrombus. So what we did, we overlapped another Firehawk 3:13 into the vessel, and this is the final result. So everything was looking good and we were happy. This is another case, a third case, wherein a 65-year-old female presented to us with anterior wall MI. This is a XB 3.5 7 French guiding catheter. We did the thrombus aspiration for the lady. We had these images. We had a decent sized diagonal. We did some pre-dilatation and there was a significant mismatch as well as the mid segment and the distal segment was involved. So we used a 2.75:33 Firehawk stent after putting another wire for saving the diagonal. This is how it looked like after we had deployed the stent. We had a decent distal landing zone and a good adequate dilatation, some thrombotic lesion at the ostium of the diagonal. We decided to do a post dilatation because we were of the view that this would require some post dilatation. So 3.5 post dilatation was done. And suddenly, and this is a snuggle balloon dilatation to prevent the vessel, the diagonal going down. There's a 2 mm balloon in the side branch and the 2.75 NC track into the main one. At the stent boost image for before the final pot, we could see there is a fracture at the bend, that the struts had gone. So although everything was fine, both the branches were flowing, we had a good result. 2 days later, we decided to do the IVUS of this lady. And these are the IVUS images that we found. At this time, we had IVUS in our lab. So we wanted to be sure whether our aggressive post-dilatation had produced some stent fracture. We had a good landing zone and we could see that adequate post-dilatation had been stent. And the area where the stent fractured between the 12 to 3 o'clock position, the struts were not to be seen. The slide which I missed, this was a type 1 stent fracture, so we decided nothing is to be done. She remains fine. So what have I learned during these cases? What is most important is, as far as stent fractures are concerned, awareness of following factors is important. Knowledge of the individual stent architecture and stent expansion characteristics. When I went through the literature, I found the maximum amount of longitudinal deformation and stent fractures have been reported with stents which have two connectors. As far as the PROMAS element that we used, it has two connector design, and this new stent by MicroPort up to 3 millimeter size, these are also having two connectors. So all these make them excellent for deliverability, but the radial strength is slightly less. Understanding the anatomical scenario, when there is a proximal or distal mismatch, angulation and calcium, or where you have done an inappropriate site selection, overzealous post-dilatation. These are the scenarios where stent fractures can happen. In our case, we were lucky that nothing happened, but there are reported cases where cardiovascular events may go up. Thank you for patient listening.